Hello everybody, my name is Jeff Heath. Welcome back to the Vintage Workshop. Today I'm going to have a discussion about plane making. Specifically, we're going to be doing a series here about making planes, and we're going to start out by discussing the tools of a plane maker, the tools that I use to go through the process. That way, as we're going through the build process of making planes, you guys will understand a little bit more about specifically what I'm doing and when I'm doing it. Of course, I'll explain that as I go, but this first video is basically going to set up the series so that you have an idea, so that if you want to follow along and maybe give it a go for yourself, which I highly recommend and encourage, that you'll have at least an understanding and an idea of some of the tools that you're going to need. I'm not saying at all that you guys are going to need everything that I've accumulated. I've been doing this for a short time, probably about five and a half years, and I've pretty much gone ahead and accumulated the tools that I need to make the planes that I want to, that I make for not only myself but for customers as well. But like in everything in woodworking and everything else in life, there's always more than one way to do it. I will show you some of the tools that I have. I'll also try when I can to give you an alternative tool that maybe you can use that maybe is a little bit less expensive if you're just going to be doing it for yourself or just want to give it a shot. So before we discuss the tools, though, I want to cover one topic that's very important to me. I want you guys to know that all the things that we're going to be discussing, obviously, are not, it's nothing that I've discovered or invented for myself. Everything I know about plane making, I owe to my strong desire to learn as much about it as I possibly can by reading and by participating in online forums where other plane makers were working. And in particular, I want to give a lot of credit for pretty much everything that I know to a guy by the name of Larry Williams. For those of you who don't know, Larry Williams has been an American plane maker for quite some time now. I'm not a historian, so I don't know when he started. I know he's still making planes today down in Arkansas. Originally, he started out in a company named Clark & Williams, and they were making probably the finest contemporary wooden hand planes that you could buy today. And brand spanking new, that he would ship them out, and I mean, they worked perfectly. I don't own any myself, but I have had the great opportunity of using some of the tools that he's made in the shops of other guys who do own them, and pretty much it was my inspiration for wanting to go ahead and get started making planes myself. As far as Larry goes, he and I met, I actually met Larry online, not in person, probably roughly about 20 years ago. I'm sure most of you are familiar with a magazine called Fine Woodworking Magazine. They had an online woodworking forum that was called The Knots, and that was my first place online where I actually began to participate on a regular basis. And I met a lot of great guys, a lot of amateur woodworkers, and a lot of professional woodworkers all around the country and all over the world, actually. And we always had very lively discussions on all the different topics. Woodworkers are a passionate crew, you guys know that. Always the arguments about the best way to do this, best way to cut dovetails, best way to sharpen a chisel. Oy, yi, yi. That one drives me crazy. But at any rate, Larry was an active participator in that forum as well. And I knew right away that when he was talking about something in print that I needed to be paying attention because the guy knows what he's talking about. So I just wanted to go ahead and give a shout out to him and make sure that everybody's very clear in understanding that I'm giving all credit where credit is due. A lot of the information that I'm going to be sharing with you is stuff that I learned from Larry, both in speaking to him online as well as he put out a great DVD on making planes I think it was produced through Lee Nielsen Toolworks, but there are several DVDs there, both he and his new partner Don McConnell. And by the way, they're not called Clark & Williams anymore, they're called Old Street Tool now, manufacturing planes because he has a new partner. And the DVD that I learned the most from is a DVD that's all about making side escapement planes. What's a side escapement plane? Well, let me show you. A side escapement plane is a wooden plane that obviously is built for planing wood. There are many different types of molding planes, hollows and rounds, side bead planes, rabbit planes like this one, which you guys have seen before, rebate planes, rabbit planes. At any rate, a side escapement plane has a escapement cut into the side, and the wedge is shaped on an angle so that when you're planing wood, the shavings actually come up through the mouth and out the side of the plane, which would be on the bench side of the plane. You guys are probably very familiar with metal planes where the shavings come up down through the top on a bench plane. These come out through the side. So that's the reason why they're called that. There may be other reasons why they call them that too, but I don't pay too much attention to those types of things. So I just wanted to share that with you. Another thing that I want to give Larry credit for is he has done extensive work in researching not only the history of plane making, but also the numbering systems that are used for basically giving a particular plane a size designation so that when you pick it up, you pretty much know, as long as you understand the system, what size hollow or what size round or what size OG or what size crown molding, etc., etc., etc. There's lots of different kinds, but he's created a numbering system with his partner that they use for designating the different sizes of the planes. I believe from reading and listening to his DVD that he is basing this very strongly on his research into British planes from the mid to late 1700s and into the early 1800s. And at any rate, it works. American plane makers over on this continent in the United States, if you go ahead and you look at companies like Ohio Tool, and I mean, there's a whole bunch of them. I noticed that if you go ahead and buy, for instance, a half inch hollow and round from one company, it has a completely different number attached to it, than a hollow and round of the exact same size from a different company. And I think it's a lot more helpful to follow a system that is more linear in terms of being able to pick something up and knowing exactly what you are working with without having to break out a caliper to measure it. So the planes that I make follow precisely the layout that Larry has created. And in his DVD, he actually has PDF files where you can actually print them up, and they actually give all the sizes of all the different planes. They discuss the anatomy of a plane, and they give the different sizes of all the parts of the plane, like the body, the grip, the mouth, the wedge. This here's a wedge. So if you guys want to learn more about that, you're not going to get that from me, because I feel like that's Larry's intellectual property and I learned it from him. You guys need to buy the DVD. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how I use that information to make the planes that I make, not only for myself, but also that I sell to customers. So let's get on with that. The most important other tool besides your brain is your workbench, your work surface. And you don't have to go out and build a $3,000 workbench. But what I do recommend is if you're going to get into hand tooling, you need a heavy bench that's very stiff, very rigid, and is at the proper height so that you can get over the top of it and work. This particular bench, which you guys have seen before, and in an upcoming video, I'm going to go through it completely and show you how I built it, etc., etc. But for now, it's a very heavy bench. It's a solid 5-inch thick maple top. It's built in the Ribot style. I've got the Benchcrafted vices on it. I've got the wagon vise at one end. I've got the leg vise at the other end. I love it. It's fantastic. And the best thing about it is that it's very heavy. I don't know what it weighs. I'm guessing somewhere in the neighborhood of 600 or 700 pounds. My son and I had one heck of a time rolling it over when I finally attached it to the base. So I know it's very heavy. And that's going to be critical for you, because when you're working with hand tools, you're going to be applying a lot of racking force in every direction, and you don't want your bench, you know, wiggling and wobbling around, because it will affect the quality of your work. So once you've got those things under wraps, the next thing you got to decide is what species of wood are you going to be building these planes out of. The traditional choice is obvious. It's always been beech, either European beech over in Europe or American beech here in the United States, in North America. Beech is not an easy wood to procure. I have had varying degrees of success in obtaining it. Sometimes it's available. When the word gets out that it's available at one place, they seem to run out very quickly, and for whatever reason, and then you're moving on. So I have also discovered that there are a lot of other good quality species of wood to use, and really it's curtailed to the type of tool that you're going to be making. If you're going to be using a high wear tool, meaning it wears a lot, you're using it every day, all day long, you definitely want to stick to the higher, harder ranges of tools, species of wood. But one of the great plane making woods that I use a lot is American cherry. Cherry is a fantastic wood for making planes. Here's some plane billets for some tools that I'm actually making right now for a couple of different customers. And cherry makes great wood for that. Also, you guys, I'm sure, are very familiar with sugar maple, hard maple. Here's a billet of maple for making planes. Stuff is very hard, heavy, and dense. The downside of that is it's also a little tougher on your tools, but it's also a lot harder to make because it doesn't cut as easy, doesn't float as easy, doesn't chisel as easy. So I've made some planes out of maple, and they're fantastic tools, but it is a little bit harder to work than some of the fruit woods and also the beech. So you've also got American birch. Birch is another tool that was widely used, and if you buy planes from North America, you know, maybe 100, 125 years old, you'll find quite a few of them were made in birch. You'll also see a lot of planes made out of apple, which is also another excellent quality wood for saw totes, saw handles. And also you've got pear, which is another great wood, very similar to cherry and apple, and also plum. I've seen some really nice tools made out of plum, and I've actually got an entire set of carving chisels whose handles are made out of plum, and I whack the crap out of them, guys, with a mallet all the time, because when I do chiseling, I'm not messing around. I want to get done, and they've held up beautifully. I mean, there's not a mark on them. So also, you know, a very hard, good quality tool. I'm sorry, species of wood to use as a plane billet. You can also get into some exotic woods. And one other North American wood that I did forget to mention, which I don't want to pass up, white oak, quarter sawn white oak, rock hard, very good, hard to work, just like the maple. In fact, harder to work in my opinion, but also makes a great, great, great quality, high wearing plane. Now you get into some of the exotic woods, and you know, once again, you can up your hardness level, so they become a lot more difficult to work. Here's a big plain billet of Bobinga that I have, a particularly heavy and dense billet, and I've made quite a few smoothing planes out of this particular wood that work very well, and you know, great wood, but once again, hard to work with, much harder to work with than some of the softer species. Here's African blackwood. I made a small plane out of this. I don't think I'll ever do that again. This stuff is almost as hard as ebony, at least this chunk that I had. This was a much bigger chunk at one time. I'm down to just about this much left of it. And actually, I've been using this as excellent wedge stock because it's so hard. You hit it on the end of the wedge with a hammer, and I think it dents the brass hammer before it actually dents the wood. And then another really, really excellent quality wood, which is just beautiful, is olive wood. This is a billet that I actually bought from a Turner store that was coated in wax and everything. And I think I bought this, geez, 5, 6, 7 years ago, and it was soaking wet. So I had to let it dry. I've had it sitting here in the shop, but very soon I'm actually going to turn this into a miter plane, more than likely for myself, because I really do fancy this particular species of wood. I've made a couple of infills for other planes made out of olive wood, and it's a hard, dense wood, but it takes a shining beautifully. So another really good quality wood. So enough with the woods. I think you guys get the idea that you're looking for a hard, dense hardwood that is going to hold up to wear. And another thing to point out here is that some tools like side bead planes, they'll have what's called boxing in them. I'm sure you guys have seen that. Here's an example of some boxing right here. It's the little piece that is basically inset into and glued into with hide glue the bottom of the plane. and that's for the purpose of creating high wear. In North America, we have our very own indigenous ebony species called persimmon. I've actually bought an entire box of this stuff from a sawyer who had a lot of this in stock. This is just one small piece that I've been working off the end on. And you go ahead and you take boxing, you cut it on the bias. What that means is whatever your bed angle is, and we'll discuss that a little bit later, but let's say you're bedding a plane at 50 degrees, you would go ahead and cut this at a 50 degree angle, and you would have the end grain of the persimmon facing down. I'm sure some of you guys know about golf clubs. The old wooden clubs were all made out of persimmon. Very, very, very extremely hard, dense wood that is excellent for boxing, along with boxwood, lignum vitae. There's quite a few choices. There's always more than one choice. So all right, so we've covered that. So you've got your billet, you've gone ahead and you've squared it up, you've cut it to size, and you know, you use your size chart depending on the size of the plane that you're making, and you want to make sure you have nice square flat billets to work with so that your joinery is going to be accurate as you work your way around the billet. So in doing that, once you rough it to size, the very first thing you make after you're going to go ahead and have your billets made is your wedge. And the reason why you're going to do that first is, I've learned from Larry, is that the wedge sets the tone for the entire plane, because you're actually going to use your wedge in the plane blank once you cut open the escapement to go ahead and set the top of the plane, the throat opening. And by marking off your wedge instead of using measuring tools and transferring measuring tools, you're eliminating the possibility of error. And guys, taking a little step aside from plane making, you guys should learn to do this type of marking on your projects all the time instead of relying on rulers, because rulers are only as accurate as the guy holding the ruler. And if you just, you move it, wiggle it around just a little bit, that's where you start introducing a little bit of error. So whenever you're marking like a mortise or a tenon, I don't use a ruler to mark those items out. I locate them in general practice on the tool, on the piece of wood. If I'm cutting a mortise for a tenon or a tenon for a mortise, depending on which way I do it, use one to mark the other. So here's an example of that. Here's a plain blank, and this is not something that's going to get sold to anybody. I just roughed this out really quick out of a piece of scrap, so nobody make fun of me with the nada and stuff up in the corner. This isn't going to anybody. This is just for this video. And you go ahead and, you set up the plane, and I'm going to get into how you set the angles and all that in just a second. But once you have your escapement cut open, you're actually going to stick the wedge in there. Excuse me, let's put it in correctly. And you're going to see that it fits perfectly, and you're going to run those lines up on the side of the wedges to the top of your plane, and that's how you're going to mark the opening of the throat, which is where the wedge feeds through, which is going to hold the iron in place. So very important. So once we have our wedge stock, and our wedge stock is quarter sawn stock. Here's a whole bunch of it. I've got stacks of it over there. When you're sizing your billets, you're going to start out with, inch and a quarter stock, and one particular plane might be 9/16 overall width. So you're going to, cut a big slice of that off, and you're going to have cutoffs. Well, this cutoff stuff is excellent, excellent wedge stock. So what I do is, every plane has a wedge requirement as far as size goes, and that's in the chart. So in this particular case, this is a quarter inch wedge, which I'm using for a number 4 plane. Is that right? Yes. No, that is not correct. This is for a number 8 plane, excuse me. So I'll go ahead, and this is where I do things a little bit differently than Larry had recommended, but I'll go ahead and I'll take the entire hunk of cutoff, and I will hand plane the entire thing down and measure it perfectly until I have it at exactly a quarter of an inch. And how you're doing that is, you're doing it with a hand plane, planing down. You're making sure you're staying flat, so you're constantly checking it with a straight edge. And then you're going to be using, a caliper. A caliper is a very valuable tool that everybody should have in their workshop if they're doing any kind of precision measuring. So I'll go ahead and I'll take the caliper, and I'll make sure that on three points on either side, okay? Middle and each corner, and then I'll also go down the middle just to verify that I've got everything down to a quarter of an inch. And with a smoothing plane, it's very easy to take a few thousandths shaving, set very finely so that you can get your wedge stock to the correct size. Once you do that, then you're switching from hand tool use, for me, over to power tool use. This is a little jig that I made up, and Larry didn't cover this much in the DVD other than to show a photo of it. I just copied it. Wedges on these are set at 10.5 degrees. So that's the angle, the acute angle of the wedge. So I went ahead and used a machinist protractor, which is, in this particular case, a tool that I already had. This is a Sterrett number 359. This is a really nice tool. This actually measures to 1/12 of 1 degree. So 5 degrees of arc. So every degree that you have is broken down into 12 different segments with a little vernier dial. So very nice to have. Also pretty expensive. I don't expect you guys to just run out and buy one of these unless you find one used. I've actually got two of these because I got lucky two times and found them in large lot sales included, and picked this one up actually recently. But you go ahead and you make your jig, and you mount your wedge stock in there, and this is just a toggle clamp that I'll stick the wedge in, kind of holding it here, push it down, and you can hear it click in place. This locks. Well, I've made this board 7.5 inches. So I'll go over to my table saw, set the fence at 7.5 inches, and I'll go ahead and rip this through, and this gives me two perfect pieces of wedge stock for doing what I got to do, because there's one on each side. So, and if you go ahead, in this particular instance, we're working with wedge stock that's 1 3/8 inches wide. So if you cut your wedge strips, once you've got them planed down to 1 3/8 inch strips, when you go ahead and run them through the table saw, it gives you two very nice cutoffs that look exactly like this, okay? And what you do is you have one wedge laying around that you use, and this one's mine. You use this as your layout tool. And I'll just go ahead and take this and lay it over the top, and I will trace it out. So, that works great. And then you take your scroll saw, your hand saw. For me, it's the band saw with a 1/8 inch fine blade. And you go ahead and get these set, and then you get some sandpaper and maybe a little wedge, a rasp or a file, and go ahead and make these so that they're nice and smooth and ready to go. So before we move into the hand tool stuff, I know I'm kind of at a far shot here. I'm going to move you guys in and give you guys a better view of the top of the bench here so that you guys can have a better visual on the tools that I'm talking about. Okay, so now we've got our plain billets and we've got our wedge stock set, and what we want to do now is just very quickly lay out the plane. Planes are made 10 inches long, meaning this width, by 3 3/8 inches high, which is this width, by varying degrees of thickness depending on which particular plane we're making. And so what you want to do is you always want to determine which of these is going to be the toe end and which is going to be the heel end. And what that means is which is going first to determine what side of the plane you're going to cut the escapement on. So we've determined in this particular plane that this is the toe, and the reason why is because the grain is running down this way. And the reason why you want to do that so that you don't run into a short grain problem here at the mouth where you're getting breakout because you've got little tiny pieces after a high angle cut. So now that we've established that, because our finish plane is going to be 10 inches, we know that our plane is going to be 1/2 inch long on both the toe and the heel. So we have to account for that whenever we're doing the layout. On the finish plane, we want our mouth opening to be at 3 3/4 inches back from the toe of the plane. So in this particular instance, we're going to take a ruler, which is another tool you guys got to have, and we're going to set, in my case, it's my hook ruler, and we're going to set that mouth at exactly 4 1/4 inches. And that's to the back of the bed. Okay, the bed is the angle that the iron is pressed, wedged against, and the front part of the escapement is called the breast, so you guys know the terms. So once we have that set, we'll go ahead and we'll lay that out on a plane blank, and you guys are going to have to make a few jigs for yourself for sawing, And I've actually got these made out for all the different angles. And these particular jigs are just cut up waste. And what this is a jig that I will go ahead and it's cut at the correct bed angle depending on what I'm using. So I'm going to go ahead and turn this around so I'm showing you how I'll do it. I'll go ahead and clamp this in my bench. And this is where, you know, your tools are very important so that you can do that. Here's a little bench dog. You can stick a 3/4 inch hole on one side. If you don't have a big wagon vise or a tail vise or, you know, whatever kind of vise you decide to use, you can literally just make something up. Where is it at? Here it is. Veritas sells this cute little guy called, I believe it's called a bench pup. And you can stick this down in one of your holes that is already drilled in your dog hole. And this acts like a vise to press up against the side of it. So nice little jig to have there. And once you have your angle set, like so, I'm going to go ahead and clamp this in place so that it's being held down so you guys can see what I'm doing. And also I'll be able to free up my hands here. And don't worry about how accurate I'm being. I'm just doing this for a demo. And you'll go ahead and you'll take a very finely filed crosscut saw. This particular one is one of my favorites. It's a Mike Wenzloff and Sons that I bought quite a while back. And you will basically be sawing down until you don't want to hit the grip, but you want to saw down to the bottom of the mouth, which is stuff that you've laid out on the plane. There are marks down on the bottom of this plane, which I'll show you in a minute. So you're making that cut down, and that establishes, you know, the bed. And then another extremely important tool, and Larry teaches this, and I didn't know why he was teaching it until I started trying to do it on my own. Lee Nielsen makes these 1/10 inch chisels, and these things, I just tell you right out of the gate, if you want to make planes, this is one tool I think you have to buy. And the reason being is because the 1/10 of an inch here is nice and thin enough so that you can use it as not only the layout tool for once you cut your breast, then you go ahead and you'll remove all this and you'll put this on here and you will mark the line on the other side of the 1/10 inch chisel, and that's going to be your breast line. But this chisel is the correct width so that you can use it to get in from the mouth side, and it'll actually feed up into the mouth and be able to work the wood that you're trying to remove out of the escapement back and forth. Here's an example of what most folks have, which is an 1/8 inch chisel. Here's an 1/8 inch chisel that I have. This is an old Greenlee part of my set. It's a mortising chisel that I've turned into a paring chisel by just filing a very, very acute angle, something like 22 degrees there. This 1/8 inch chisel will not fit in that mouth. If I use this chisel down here to try and open up this escapement from the bottom, I am going to wreck this plane because the mouth is going to be so wide that when I go to bed and seat the iron, the mouth opening is going to be too big and the plane is not going to work as well as it could be. So 1/10 inch chisel. So taking this apart now, we've got our breast cut. I'm sorry, we've got our bed cut. Then we go ahead, we measure over with the 1/10 inch chisel, we stick our other jig on the other side, and we go ahead and we cut our breast angle. So now we've got our escapement clearly defined. Let me get rid of this clamp here. So we've got that clearly defined. We've sawn down to the correct depth. And here's an example of how you mark out. I'm hoping you guys can see that. That is the bottom. Where I've cut to is the bottom of the mouth. So you're going to cut down to those two lines, and that's going to basically set up the waste on both sides of the cut that you're going to need to remove. So now you're going to go ahead and you're going to get in here with that chisel, and you're going to start working that material out. The other part of the material that you're going to be working out, let me grab another plane blank that's very close to the same, where's it at? I have one here somewhere. Oh, way over there. So here's another plane blank. Here's another plane blank that's just laid out with the grip, the shoulder, and so once we cut this out, we will be cutting down for the ramp. And what the ramp is the ramp is the transition part of the grip of the plane down to the escapement where the wedge and the iron are seated, and that creates the side escapement. And it's actually cut down at an angle, and it's called the ramp. So you're going to be doing that with chisels, and that brings us to the next tool that you guys are going to need, which is a good, decent set of chisels. And I've got old vintage chisels. I prefer them. The steel on old vintage chisels is every bit as good, if not better, than most of the tools that are available new today from certain import places. But, a Lee Nielsen tool, great chisels. I used to have a set, but they're also kind of pricey. Nothing against them. But, most of these chisels here, guys, I paid less than $10 a piece for. The Stanleys, these are $7.50s. These hold more collector value for some unknown reason to me, not being a collector. So these end up costing a little bit more. But I've got a full set of these that I've accumulated over the years. And I've got a full set of paring and bench chisels from Greenlee that I picked up. I don't think I paid more than 10 bucks a piece for any of the chisels. And the steel is outstanding. So if you can tune up a chisel, buy yourself a couple of vintage chisels to start. You won't have a ton of money invested. You go to flea markets, etc. And as long as you know the right names of the old vintage makers, even if you end up with one bad chisel that got used as a can opener, or somebody took it to a grinder and literally heated it up to the point of bluing it and ruined the temper on the steel, you're still going to be way ahead of the game dollars and cents wise until you figure out what you want to do. This is also another favorite of mine. This is a Marilyn Wilder, which is an American-made plane maker from the late 1800s. And this is my dedicated paring chisel. This is a 3/4-inch chisel made of great steel. I mean, the stuff is outstanding, wears well, and also has a kind of an upswing to the handle. So you can get in there and you can work flush on something and your hand is still up in the air behind it. So really nice. As you can see, I've cut this at 20 degrees. That does weaken the tip of the chisel, the point of the chisel a little bit, but I'm only paring with it. So I use that for getting in to little areas where I got to do just ever so light paring. And you got to have a good set of chisels. The sizes that you'll end up using the most on this are going to be the 10th inch chisel for opening up the mouth. You're going to need a 3/8 inch chisel for chiseling down in front of the ramp and creating the mortise that you're going to go ahead and pair to with the 10th inch chisel to open up the escapement. A couple of the other tools that I certainly feel like it's worth mentioning are you're going to have to be able to smooth out your plane billets. And for that, obviously, you're going to be using a smoothing plane. Here's a Lee Nielsen 4.5, one of my favorites. And also, my favorite is a plane that I actually made myself, and this is made out of maple. This is a 50-degree smoothing plane that I made in the coffin style. Another plane that I recently acquired that my wife bought me for Christmas, thanks, honey, is this Lee Nielsen 610. And what this is this is I think it's called a carriage maker or a coach maker's plane. And what it is it's a low-angle rabbeting plane that has an iron that is full width. Unlike a normal bench plane, where the mouth is, forget about these marks here, where the mouth is, going to have shoulders on the sides, this particular plane has the iron going full width. So you're actually able, on a billet like this, where you've got this shoulder, you're actually to get right in that corner and smooth that out perfectly, and you can set this to a super fine shaving so that I'm able to take a couple thousandths per pass and very quickly and accurately get these shoulders and these grips tuned in. And this was a great addition. I mean, this cut off a lot of time for me. I was using my other shoulder plane, but my other shoulder plane is 1.25 inches wide, and these shoulders, these grips are 1.5 inches. So you're having to make multiple passes back and forth and make sure you're not creating tapers and stuff like that. So a couple other noteworthy tools that if you're going to get into it, I'm certainly not saying you're going to go out and spend that kind of money if you're just going to make yourself one set of planes, but if you're going to get involved in plane making, this is, in my opinion, another must-have tool. Like I said before, calipers. I've actually got a set that I use for woodworking, which is measured in 64ths of an inch, and I've got another set which I use in metalworking, which is required in metalworking. This is a sterret that measures in 1/1000ths of an inch. My favorite that layout tool for measuring that I've been using for a really long time when it comes to actually marking out, and you'll notice that the top of these billets will have the throat openings marked on them, as well as the mouth openings, is this Incra 6-inch rule. This works in conjunction with one of those 0.5 millimeter pencil tips that I've got around here somewhere. There it is. And this tool is great. If you put this in your bench vise, this is great for accurate measurements. Rather than taking, a lot of guys will take a square, just a regular square, and they'll set it to what they think is 3/8 of an inch visually, and then they'll use, the edge of it to run it down. I don't like doing it that way because I don't think it's very accurate. Yeah, you can go back and forth a couple of times until you got it dead accurate by measuring it, checking it, erasing it, doing it again. This thing is dead nuts, bullets on every single time. So I use it because this particular Incra rule has divisions in 64ths of an inch, which is, what I work in. And because of that, I'm able to just stick the pencil lead in here and go. So another very valuable and really necessary tool, which is very little money, is you got to run down to your hobby store, Hobby Lobby, whatever craft store, and you got to get yourself a circle template. This is one of the two that I have. I also have the other one back in the drawer with the smaller circles. What this does is this gives you a template of all the different circles so that when you're making a half inch hollow and round, or you're making a 5/16 hollow and round, which is a number 5, or a 1/4 inch number 4, you go ahead and you pick out the appropriate circle and you use this on the bottom of the plane for marking out your arcs. Because another nice tool that I like having, which is great for both metalworking and woodworking, is a radius gauge set. This is an old set. I've had this for a very long time. I think this was a hand-me-down from a relative. And a radius gauge is a precision metalworking kind of gauge that is, these are made in the USA. These are General, made in the USA, and I've got a full set of them. I've got all the radiuses inside, so this gets me exactly what I need with regards to setting up radiuses. So really good extra tool to have. Let's see, what else? I think I've got, we talked about the fancy protractor before. You certainly don't have to invest in that. You can go ahead. This is a sterret that I use. I actually have a couple of these and squares. And if you buy a good square set, it's going to come with a centering tool, which I don't have here, which is great for if you're doing turnings. It's also going to have just your regular 90 degree and 45 degree square, as well as a very accurate rule. This is a sterret as well. And this is their protractor head. And while this is not divided into 1/12th of a degree, you could certainly eyeball it well enough to get in between, let's say you got a 55 degree bed angle, you can get between the 54 and the 55, center it up, and you, as long as you use this same tool at that setting to set up your jig for cutting your wedges, this is going to be more than good enough. And sometimes these are pretty expensive, but if you're patient, guys, and you check out Craigslist or one of the auction sites, I think I picked up an entire set of these for like $40, and they're all sterret. So good stuff, cheap investment, and I've had these for a long time. And these things are tempered hard; they don't rust, and they hold up very well. So another good tool to have in the workshop, and certainly something that you're going to need for setting depths and angles, etc., etc., on the planes. One of the last tools that I'm going to discuss here is really a specialty tool, but boy, I tell you what, I'm so glad that I found these particular tools for my woodworking, because it has made life a lot easier for me for a lot more than just plane making. These are my set of Planemaker's floats. These are available, once again, at Lee Nielsen. I don't want you guys sounding like to think like I'm plugging them all the time. It's just that they're an American-made company, which is very important to me. And they also make excellent high-quality tools. Those of you guys who already own some of their stuff already know that all their stuff is great. And they actually make these Planemakers floats. And it's my understanding that before they started making these in the last decade or so, probably less than that, is that most Planemakers were making these themselves out of old files. So what we have here is a bed float, and this is critical for basically filing or floating down a bed so that it's perfectly flat and level across. And this is a cheek float. This is a smaller float that gets into some of the smaller side areas like on bench planes where you just want to get down a little bit into the cheeks to remove a little bit of material. These are two different taper angle floats. They're both at different angles. One is excellent for the escapements and getting down into the throat of the planes. So once you've opened up the top of your mouth, you can actually, the top of your throat, you can get this plane down in there and, you know, and work the sides, the blind side as well as the escapement side of your throat, and opening that up so you can get the wedge to fit properly. Same thing with this tool, as well as on slightly larger wedges like on bench planes, if you're doing like a 12 degree wedge on a bench plane, because that's what this one is set at. And then these guys are edge floats. This one's an 1/8 inch edge float, this one's a 3/16, and these kind of work like saw files on steroids. What you do is, you know, when you're opening up your mouth, you basically, your throat here on this particular style of plane, you're going to go ahead and you're going to drill a couple of holes at the appropriate angles to break through way down here into that escapement that you've already opened up like a mortise. And once you do that, you're going to get in with your 1/8 inch chisel and you're going to work that material down as far as you can. But at some point, you're going to get to a point where you're not going to be able to get further in there. And that's where these edge floats are great, because you can get down in there and you can very carefully work right up to your lines, squaring up your edges and your corners, and great tools. So and covering, keeping these sharp, these guys, I don't know what the Rockwell hardness is on them, but I would say they're somewhere between a file and a chisel. And the reason why I say that is because how you sharpen these guys, and I'm not going to cover it right now, but you cover it, just to tell you how it's done, is you use a triangular saw file. These are 6-inch double extra slim saw files. I mean, I use these like crazy, so I buy them by the box. I've got a couple boxes left. In fact, my old supplier doesn't even carry these anymore, so when I run out of these, I'm going to have to find another supplier of these. So if anybody knows of one, by all means, these are Baco files. I found that these are very, very, very well made. They're made in Portugal, and excellent quality files. I use these for sawing, filing all my saw blades too, hand saws. But you would take these, and you would basically, when these start to dull up, you probably see a little bit of remnants from red layout fluid. I'll lay it out with red layout fluid, joint them flat first so you get all the teeth at the same height, and then using this as a demonstrator, you just come on in here and you very rigidly and horizontally sharpen across until you've got these teeth all sharp. This one I just did before I started shooting this video. This guy's, you know, razor sharp. So excellent tools for opening up mouths, and not only on escapement planes but also on bench planes as well. All right, guys, that's going to basically cover it for most of the tools that I'm going to be using over the course of making planes. I just wanted to share this with you. I hope you guys find this helpful and interesting. Obviously, there are a few other tools that I left out, things like drills, whether you're going to do it by hand with an auger or a bicycle wheel, or if you're going to use a regular cordless drill, or even set up a jig in your drill press. I've actually done that because I make enough of them to where it warranted setting up a jig so that it's much faster for me. But at any rate, thanks for watching. I hope you guys enjoy this. If you guys feel like I left anything out, or if there's other things that you want to see with, or if you have any specific questions regarding this, please make sure you leave a comment down below. And I try very hard to get back to you guys on all those comments. This week was a little rough on me. I don't know if you can tell by the sound of my voice, but I ended up catching a bug earlier this week, knocked me out for about 3 days, and I'm starting to feel better now, but I think it's the change in the weather. So I definitely plan on getting back at it and getting back in, and I've got some comments that I want to make sure I respond to. So I know I spend a lot of time talking about it, but I really do enjoy the comments you guys leave, and so please continue to do that. If you're interested in what you're seeing here and you like the channel, please go ahead and hit that subscribe button and subscribe to the channel, because there's going to be a lot more information to come. Upcoming videos within the planemaking series are going to be, I'm going to show you guys how to lay out the billets, and then I'm going to actually go through a step-by-step process of just showing you how each of the parts are made, as well as discussing bed angles, the tapers, and all the different components that make up a plane. So I have no idea at this point how many parts the video is going to be, but I do want to be detailed with you. So if they run a little long and you want to fast forward it, so be it, but you're going to miss some good stuff. So at any rate, for now, like I said before, my name's Jeff Heath, and so long from the Vintage Workshop.